Greetings. Provocative title, huh? Most people in Islam may not even bother to listen, learn, or pay attention. But I hope you will listen as I lay out every painful detail of the proof of my assertion. So let me first of all lay out my thesis statement in a clear and understandable way. Islam allows blasphemous teaching techniques to spread Islam. Islam does this by adopting a passive position, that anything said which converts someone is okay. And Islam even allows twisting prophecies about Allah as if they refer to Mohammed, thus claiming for Mohammed and ascribing to Mohammed the fulfillment of prophecies only Allah may fulfill. And this essentially means that Islam accepts Muhammad acting as and getting credit for being Allah. Now, I am not saying, and this is important, that the Quran contains a statement in simple, unambiguous text, Muhammad is Allah, worship me. I am saying that Islam allows claims that indirectly, yet logically, treat Muhammad as Allah. And so that my statement may be established, I will produce two witnesses. Two clear examples where prophets, speaking of Allah, are claimed to refer to Muhammad. May the Spirit of God allow your eyes to open that you may see the truth. When a prophet speaks of Allah, the Lord of the worlds, is it okay to use those words and say that those words really refer to a man? I do not think so. When a prophet speaks of Almighty God, the Almighty God that Islam calls Allah, is it okay to say, no, no, those words are not of Allah, they are of a man? I do not think so. Would it depend on who said the words? What if I told you it was Muhammad who said the words? Would that make a difference? How about if it was Jesus that said the words? Would those carry less weight than Muhammad? What if it were only Moses who had spoken the message? Would that still count? Do you honor Moses the same as you honor Muhammad? I call to the witness stand my first witness against Islam. Prophet Moses. Deuteronomy 33, verse 2. He said, the Lord came from Sinai and dawned over them from Seir. He shone forth from Mount Paran. He came with myriads of holy ones from the south, from his mountain slopes. Notice who this verse is talking about. The Lord. This is Prophet Moses speaking about Yahweh, the God of Abraham. In another language, Allah. And notice there are several pronouns presented here in this English translation. 1. He. 2. He. 3. He. The first pronoun refers to Moses, who was named in the previous verse of this chapter. The next two refer to the Lord, and we know this because the Lord is the only other active antecedent. The Lord. Now, before you get too wrapped up about three he's in the same verse, we should look at the Hebrew. Deuteronomy 33:2. Said the Lord, Sinai came and dawned, Seir. Shone Mount Paran came of 10, holy. Notice anything different? Right. No pronouns. The subject about whom this refers is implied from the one clear noun, Yahweh, the Lord. So do not get wrapped up counting he, or your understanding will be laughable. And let's try one other thing to help you understand the true meaning of this verse. Let's replace the pronouns in the English text with the antecedent. From the context, we know Moses and Yahweh are the only two active nouns. So to be exhaustive and exhausting, there are eight possible combinations of applying the pronouns. He, Moses, said. He, Moses, shone forth. He, Moses, came with myriads. Oops! Just noticed a fourth pronoun. His, Moses's, mountain slopes. So if you read it where each pronoun is replaced with Moses, you get this. But it does not make much sense. Did Moses shine forth from Mount Paran? Moses did shine after meeting God face to face. Exodus 34:29. When Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tablets of the covenant law in his hands, he was not aware that his face was radiant because he had spoken with the Lord. When Aaron and all the Israelites saw Moses, his face was radiant, and they were afraid to come near him. But this was on Mount Sinai. So this cannot possibly be what Deuteronomy 33:2 is referring to. Nor would anyone from Islam argue this case because it does not serve to inject Mohammed into the Torah. So the substitution combination of Moses, 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 Moses does not make any sense. And in fact, the only place it makes sense to substitute Moses is for the first pronoun. He, Moses, said. Because in verse 1, Moses is introduced as speaking, and Moses is the only active noun. And rather than waste your time and mine presenting all 15 combinations, I'm going to suggest the obvious. The remaining three pronouns all speak of the same individual. He, Moses, said the Lord came from Sinai and dawned over them from Seir. He, whoever that may be, shone forth from Mount Paran. He, whoever that may be, came with myriads of the holy ones from the south, from his, whoever that may be, mountain slopes. All three pronouns refer to the same entity. And to Jews and Christians alike, the answer is obvious, because we read the text with respect for God, and we have no agenda except to understand what Moses said. And therefore, it is obvious to us that Moses spoke of Almighty God. Moses said, "The Lord came from Sinai and dawned over them from Seir. God shone forth from Mount Paran. God came with myriads of holy ones from the south, from God's mountain slopes." But is there any other option that makes legitimate sense? Emphasis on legitimate sense. Not really, because there are no other active nouns. There is no other open reference to a person. And this is where Islam commits blasphemy. Islam has a desperate need to have some mention of Muhammad in the Torah. This desperate need exists because Muhammad said he was mentioned in the Torah. So this is how Islam wants the text to read. Moses said, "The Lord came from Sinai and dawned over them from Seir. Muhammad shone forth from Mount Paran. Muhammad came with myriads of holy ones from the south, from Muhammad's mountain slopes." And as I have already shown, this verse is Prophet Moses speaking of Almighty God. But Islam ignores this clear sign from Prophet Moses and replaces Allah with Muhammad. If you do not think this is the case, let me know, but I am already fully aware of Islam's excuses for this sin. But I want you who call yourself Muslim to honestly think and ask yourself, have I heard Imams or Sheikhs of Islam teach that Deuteronomy 33:2 refers to Muhammad? Have I read this before as proof of Muhammad in the Torah, in the Bible? If you have not heard this, O Muslim, then you have not studied your religion very much. Watch the rest of this video and I will prove before God and man this is the case, that Islam allows this blasphemy. Yet, even more than allows, Islam has a desperate need for this blasphemy to be committed. And I'm asking myself, do you want to follow blasphemy or Almighty God? I call to the witness stand my second witness against Islam. Prophet Isaiah. Isaiah 42:13. The Lord will march out like a mighty man, like a warrior he will stir up his zeal, with a shout he will raise the battle cry and will triumph over his enemies. Again, notice who this verse is talking about. The Lord. And again, notice there are pronouns. He will stir up his zeal, will triumph over his enemies. And again, like people who respect God and the Torah, let's look at the Hebrew. Isaiah 42:13. We can go back to the original Hebrew and see exactly who this is referring to. Yahweh, the Lord. This is Yahweh, the God of Abraham. In Arabic, the only word usable is Allah. So Isaiah 42:13 is speaking of Allah. And I can easily go through the same analysis and study to prove and show the pronouns also all refer to Yahweh, who Islam tries to claim is the same as Allah. But instead, I think I need to show that Islam does substitute Muhammad here in Allah's place. I began this study having found one notable example of this, Didat's combat kit. But I think you who call yourself Muslim need to know it is not only Didat. I will do that by identifying two things. Islam actively represents that Isaiah 42:13 does refer to Muhammad. And second, by the lack of any refutation of this argument from within Islam. Here's a website, onereason.org, the other Jesus, Muhammad in the Bible. The idea that the Bible contains prophecies about the coming of Muhammad, peace be upon him, may surprise many people. It isn't difficult to understand why, since the general perception people have of the Muhammad is that of a man with no connection to biblical prophecies or prophets. This is an Islamic website introducing the strategic du'a that Muhammad is mentioned in the Torah and Bible. Later, on the same page, they get to the messenger from Arabia. The Old Testament prophesizes, that's their misspelling, the coming of a prophet from Arabia. The verses of Isaiah 42 describe the coming of a prophet. This messenger would be a man of war, who would first be persecuted and then will fight and defeat idol worshippers. Isaiah 42:13-17. So here, Isaiah 42:13 is claimed to be mention of Muhammad. Utter blasphemy. Now we have just read Isaiah 42:13, and there is no usage of the word messenger in it. Look and see how the deception of Islam is planted. If you have any respect for Prophet Moses or Prophet Isaiah, you should be shocked Islam changes his message like this. TheUnjustMedia.com, Islam, Christians, prophecy.html. The awaited prophet was to come from Arabia, Isaiah 42:1-13. Speaks of the beloved of God, meaning Muhammad, not Jesus, his elect and messenger who will bring down a law to be awaited in the isles, and who shall not fail nor be discouraged till he has set judgment on earth. Perhaps in another video I will examine usage of the beloved of God as another insertion of Islamic verbiage of Muhammad. But here Isaiah 42:1-13 is claimed to be mentioned of Muhammad. Utter blasphemy. www.islamicity.com, Mosque, Muhammad Bible HTM. The awaited prophet was to come from Arabia, Isaiah 42:1-13, speaks of the beloved of God, his elect and messenger who will bring down a law to be awaited in the isles, and who shall not fail nor be discouraged till he have set judgment on earth. And it is with this reference that you may first see the actual pattern of Islam. Like many things on the web, not just Islamic propaganda, there is one source that is copied thousands of times. Repeat a lie often enough and weak-minded people will begin to believe it. So this is three direct examples, and my Google search for Mohammed Isaiah 42:13 returned 298,000 hits. I did run into some Christian refutations of this false claim, so I'll grant that some of the hits are not Islam's blasphemous false claim. But I think a conservative estimate could easily be there are over 10,000 examples of this blasphemy, of saying these prophetic words that speak of Allah mean Muhammad. The second case is somewhat harder to prove to a legal standard. One cannot disprove the existence of something by the simple inability to find it. I cannot disprove the existence of mice in my attic because I failed to see or find one. So the statement cannot easily be proven, while it may easily be disproven. Find one mouse corpse, one mouse dropping, and you prove they do exist. So the statement cannot easily be proven, while it may easily be disproven. Thus, I leave myself willing to be embarrassed by someone in Islam. Produce the link to the Islamic website that refutes or rebukes the usage of Isaiah 42 as evidence Muhammad appears in the Torah. I doubt you will find even one, but if you do find one, ask yourself, why only one? And if you find more than one, I predict in advance they will be mere cut and paste copies of some original renegade apostate. But because replacing Allah with Muhammad is a demonstrated, replicated, repeated, duplicated blasphemy, I reject Islam. Forever. I honor the God of Abraham. I honor the prophets of the God of Abraham. I honor their message. And I will not submit to men teaching Muhammad is the Allah spoken of by the prophets. So I will forever reject Islam that teaches Muhammad is Allah. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.